You were the Word at the beginning, one with God, the Lord Most High. Your hidden glory in creation is now revealed in You are Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a beautiful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a beautiful name it is. The name of Jesus. You didn't want heaven without us, so Jesus, You brought heaven down. My sin was great, Your love was greater. So what could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a wonderful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus. Death could not hold You. The veil tore before You. You silenced the boast of sin and grave. Heavens are roaring the praise of Your glory, for You are raised to life again. You have no rival, You have no equal, now and forever, God, You reign. Yours is the kingdom, Yours is the glory, Yours is the name above all names. What a powerful name it is. What a powerful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, my King. What a powerful name it is. Nothing compares to this. What a wonderful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus.
All right, this is Lee McBride. I want to welcome you to the 6th episode of the Yak Network. So excited about what's going on, getting emails, starting to connect people together. Just wanted to tell another story from the scripture today. It's a pretty straightforward story. It comes from the 26th chapter of the book of Matthew. Now, I was in Rosebud, Arkansas about 3 or 4 weeks ago, and I was preaching. I got a good friend there, and he said, I want you to see my puppy. And it was a cow dog. And I don't know if you know anything about cow dogs. They're extremely smart, brilliant dogs. But they ain't pretty. They look like a Brillo pad with ears. I mean, they're Brillo colored. Their eyes are 2 different colors. I mean, they ain't pretty. Awesome, smart, not pretty. And he was so proud. He picked that little puppy up and he held it up to his face and said, Ain't he beautiful? And I went, no, he ain't beautiful at all. He's terrible. He looks like E.T. and he's a phone home. But to him, that guy, that puppy, to that guy was beautiful. You know, they say beauty is in the eye of the beholder. I don't know if this is important, what you consider beautiful or what I consider beautiful, but it is important to me what Christ considered beautiful. And he tells a story in Matthew chapter 26 of something that he described as beautiful. And you know, I know many of you are students, and it seems like to be 80 years old is a million years from now, but the truth is, in the picture of eternity, 80 years is not that long a time, and we're none of us are guaranteed even 80 years. I remember reading a story a Native American Indian wrote one time about eternity, and it gave me a great picture. He said, if you had a stone as big as earth and a bird flew by, and one time a day the very tail feather of the bird touched the rock, as long as it would take that bird to wear the stone as big as earth down to nothing, that's 1 second in eternity. So 80 years is a long time, but in comparison to eternity, it's really not that long. So if we could do one thing in our life on earth that the scripture describes as a vapor that Christ called beautiful, it would be fantastic. Our life would be an overwhelming success. So here's how the story goes in Matthew 26. I think it starts about verse 6. It says, they were in Bethany at the home of a man known as Simon the leper. So there's a problem with the story from the very beginning, and that don't make sense. That whole scripture makes no sense, because people who had leprosy didn't go back to their home. See, in Matthew 26, if you went to the high priest and there's a boil on your skin and he determined that was leprosy and determined you to be unclean, you never went back home again. You never hugged your spouse, your kids, your friends again. They took you, they took your clothes, they burned them, they gave you something else to wear. You stayed in a colony with only leprous people lived. You couldn't drink out of the same water stream. You couldn't bathe in the same river. Matter of fact, if you walked a common road and you had leprosy and you saw somebody coming down the road, you had to say three times when you came into their vision, unclean, 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 because they needed to know that you were a leper and they could keep a distance from you. So it says they were in Bethany at the home of a man known as Simon the leper. Simon's there and they're there. Why would they be there with a guy that had leprosy? Why is he there? Well, if you do a little study on the story, you'll find out this. What had been declared by the high priest to be unclean through the blood of Jesus Christ had been made clean. So it is a spiritual truth for us to learn at the very beginning of this story that through the blood of Christ, what is unclean can be made clean. Now, John chapter 12 tells another version of this story. Some theologians say it's not the exact same story, but there's so many similarities, it doesn't matter, even if it's not, to make the point I'm making. It says they were gathered together, and there was another guy there that had a physical ailment, and his name was Lazarus. Now, bad as leprosy is, Lazarus had a worse physical ailment than leprosy. Lazarus was dead, had died for a few days. You know, we've all read that story of somebody who died for 90 seconds, woke up, saw a light, you know, and they put up a testimony in Guidepost Magazine. But this guy had been dead for days. They hadn't been to his funeral. They hadn't had his service. They back there in the fellowship all eating tater salad, telling Lazarus' story is dead. I mean, he is graveyard dead. But Lazarus is there. How is he there? Well, just so it is true that what is unclean through the blood of Christ can be made clean, it is also true that what is dead can live again. You say, Lee, you really expect me to believe that a man died and that Christ spoke life into him and he rose from the dead? Well, how easy is it to forgive sin? How easy is it to set somebody free of sin? I mean, that ain't easy either. So that's absolutely what I'm telling you. By faith, we believe that Lazarus was dead. They had put him in they had his funeral and had put him away, and Christ spoke life into him, and he lived again. It's a biblical fact. Hard to believe, but by faith we believe it. So you got Simon there, because what is unclean can be made clean, and then you got Lazarus there because what is dead in Christ can live again. And then it tells the story of this lady. So it says they were reclining around the table after they had eaten. So you can see toothpicks, telling stories, full bellies, laughing, fellowship, maybe fixing to go take a nap. It's that kind of atmosphere. And this lady comes into this little bitty room. It's a small room. And the Bible says that she had a very expensive jar of perfume. Now, if you do a little study, you read the other accounts, it's very clear to us that this jar of perfume, it was a big jar, and that it was worth a year's wages. And she broke the perfume and poured it on Jesus. I mean, I don't know if you can imagine the stench. And even when something smells good in that small of a room, too much of it. And the Bible says that the disciples became indignant. They said, why this waste? We could have sold this perfume and give the money to the poor. These are the same dudes fixed to sell Jesus for a few coins. They ain't worried about the poor, I promise you. And Jesus said, why are you bothering this woman? He said, she has done a beautiful thing to me. Said, what she's done to anoint me for my burial, and I'll tell you the truth, where my story is told, her story will be told. And here we are, 2,000 years later, Genesis Church, Highland City, Florida, telling her story. The thing that is perplexing, that it intrigues me, is why is it considered beautiful? Why this bizarre act? These guys in this room sitting around this table just to eat, and this woman walks in with this jar of perfume. I mean, if you close your eyes, you can almost smell the stench. You know, even when something smells good, too much of it can make you nauseous. I preached a lot of middle school camps in my life. And you know, an eighth grade boy believes that Axe body spray is equal to taking a bath. And especially at camp, if they go swimming in the pool one time, they will not bathe all week. There is no smell on earth like the altar at a middle school camp, where boys have sweated and stunk and smell like one of Satan's hemorrhoids in the altar, and they're trying to cover it with $8.36 worth of Axe body spray. It's disgusting. Even when something smells good, too much of it. I remember I had a buddy. We love him, still love him, in high school. Somebody gave him for Christmas too big a bottle of Jovan Musk oil. And man, he needed to pump the brakes. He put way too much on. So you can imagine what the room smelled like. She busts this bottle, she pours it on Jesus to anoint him for his burial. Why would that be described as beautiful? Why any of it? Well, there are a couple reasons. You got to dig a little study of the story, but I believe there are two reasons that Christ described what she did as beautiful. Number one is she only had one thing on earth worth anything. She had one possession, jar of perfume. Now, I don't know what your philosophy of smell good is, cologne, perfume. My philosophy is very simple. Today, it is a true fact. I'm wearing Rolo. I don't know if you're familiar with Rolo cologne. It's $7. Smells like Polo. Rolo. Just squirt it a couple more times. Instead of a man riding a Polo pony and swinging a mallet, it's a farmer riding a donkey swinging a bush axe. But it's $7. It's $7. But this one time I was on this missions trip, I'll never forget, toughest mission trip I ever been on, in the middle of Siberia, a little country called Tuva. We traveled around in a Willis Army Jeep. It was tough. We ate boiled potatoes all week. It was just tough. I was ready to get home. I don't know if you ever been on a trip, ready to get home. I wanted to get home, snuggle up, smooch on my wife. I wanted to hug my babies, and I've been eating boiled potatoes for a week. I wanted to come home and get a dozen Crystal cheeseburgers. Didn't want no fries. I'd had enough boiled potatoes last week, 2 or 3 years. But I wanted to get chili and dip those cheeseburgers in that chili and drink it down with a chocolate shake. I wanted to get home. So we leave. Kizil Tuva fly to Krasnoyarsk, Siberia. Krasnoyarsk to Moscow. We get to Moscow. There's a guy down at the bottom of the stairs in the airport with our names on a sign. I thought, here we go. We've been getting a limo ride. It wasn't no limo ride. It was our travel agent. And they messed our flights up. And as bad as I wanted to get home so bad my body ached. We got to stay another day. So to try to make it up to us, they send us to Zurich, Switzerland. I didn't want to go to Zurich, Switzerland. I want to go to Columbus, Georgia. So they start trying to sell us. They're like, oh, that's where they make the finest timepieces on earth. I said, no, it ain't. That right there, that's a Timex Iron Man. I paid $19 for it 7 years ago. I've left it in the woods. I've washed it in the washing machine. There can't be a finer timepiece on earth. Can't be. They said, that's where they make Swiss Army knives. Well, I'm a dude. I like knives. I mean, I can skin a buck. I can run a trot line. I like guns and knives and do things. Never have understood the Swiss Army knife. It's got a corkscrew on it. At what point in your life have you been stuck in the woods or stranded somewhere? God, oh my God, if I only had a corkscrew. Why would you put a corkscrew on a survival knife? I've only found one use for the corkscrew. So like when you open a can of Vienna sausages, you could screw that middle screw down into that middle sausage and fish it out of there without tearing all of them up. That's the only use I have found for a Swiss Army knife. Listen, I just wanted to go home. I didn't want no timepiece. I didn't want no knife. I wanted to go home. So we fly to Zurich, and the guys that are with me, they go on a tour of Zurich. I didn't want to tour Zurich. I wanted to go to the hotel. I figured the quicker I lay down at the hotel, the quicker I'd wake up and we'd be going home. And I get to the hotel, and right by the hotel, there's this perfume shop. And in the front window of the perfume shop is this big blue twisty bottle of perfume, and it even had a sh-sh-sh-sh-sh-sh. I've never bought smell good with a sh-sh-sh-sh. They call it an atomizer. I got one on my Roundup jug that I used to kill weed, but I ain't never had one. I was missing my wife so bad. I wanted to hold my wife. I'm missing her. I said, I want to do something so nice for her. How much is that bottle of perfume? They said, it's like $220. I had like $280 on me. I said, I'll take it. I felt like the biggest sissy on this earth. I mean, I had to fly home with that perfume in my lap. When I got home, man, she loved it. She just milked it. She would walk through the mist. And I thought, when we get something precious in our life, that's how we return it to God. At a time, but not this lady. She had one thing in her life worth anything, and she broke it and handed it to Christ all at once. That's beautiful. That's how Christ wants our heart. There's so many people trying to give their heart a little bit at a time. This is not progressive. You don't do it by chapters. You hand Christ your heart. If it's cracked, if it's broken, if it's dark, if it's cold, it doesn't matter. You give it to him all at once. That's what he wants. The thing that's most precious to him is your heart. He wants it handed to him all at once. Another reason that I think Christ described what she did as beautiful is you got to know her past. Now, I'm not one of these guys that tries to use words to edge, give the gospel an edge or to catch your attention. I mean, it's a two-edged sword right now. How much sharper it's got to be. But I am a guy that tries really hard to be accurate to the text. And there ain't another way to say this but to say it. That lady who walked into that room with the jar of perfume and anointed Jesus for burial, before she yielded her life to Christ and before Christ had made what was unclean cleaning her life, she was a town whore. And every man in that room knew it. You go back to her first conversation with Jesus, she tried to be evasive, she tried to talk in general language, and Jesus told her right where she was. Lee, are you sitting there and telling me that God took and appointed, out of all the ladies that were living in that time, he picked a lady with that kind of past to anoint Jesus for burial? Absolutely. Because with the blood of Christ, what is unclean can be made clean. The reason that I think what she did was beautiful is, if she did that for a living in her past, if she had been with a lot of men in her past, do you think she understood the nature of men? I do. So do you think that she didn't understand when she walked into that room to do what Christ had called her to do? She knew men were going to become indignant. She knew people were going to have something to say about what she was doing. She knew she'd be criticized and judged. But she got to the point in her life where she was more concerned about what Christ had called her to do than what people were going to say about what she was doing for Christ. That is beautiful. When you get to that point in your faith where you're more concerned about obeying God than the criticism people are going to throw upon you, I think those are the two reasons that were described as beautiful. So that story says this to me. If you're watching this video, if you've got a jaded past, you say, Lee, I've ruined my reputation. This is a small town where I'm in a small church, and there's no way they could trust me because of what I've done. I'm telling you, you got to quit focusing on what they're going to say, and you focus on what God's called you to do. And when you do it, he'll take care of the rest. That's a beautiful place in faith. And the second thing I'm telling you is, you can't do this a little bit at a time. You can't give him a piece of your heart or a part of your heart or more of your heart. You give him your heart. You go all in. You invest by faith. You trust him with your heart. And I think if we'll do those two things, Christ will call what we're doing beautiful. So I'm just saying, if you're listening and you want to make a move toward Christ, or maybe you've never accepted Christ as your Savior, I want to pray with you. And I want to tell you how easy it is, because if you want to make a move toward Christ today, it's as easy as ABC. We ask him to cleanse us and forgive us our sins. We make a statement of faith. We believe that he is God's Son, one and only Son, and our one and only hope. We believe that he's Messiah, our Savior, and then we confess him as Lord. He can make what is unclean clean. You say, Lee, you just don't understand. I don't have any feeling anymore because I feel like I messed up so many times. Well, he can make what's dead live again. He can revive you. He can revive your heart. He can bring joy to your life. Let's pray. Lord, if there's anybody watching this video, we want to do something beautiful, and the most beautiful thing we can do is to yield our heart to you all at once. To yield our heart to you all at once. And to not be concerned about the failures of our past, and to certainly not let them stop us from what you've called us to do in the present. Lord, if there's a student that needs to make a move, It's just as easy as ABC, that they would ask for forgiveness, make a statement of faith believing that you are Jesus Christ, God's one and only Son, Messiah, and confess you as their Lord. And Lord, if there's a student watching, I just pray that they would understand that you love them, that you gave your life for them, that you'll do anything for them. Father, if anybody listening has a question, anybody needs a prayer, that they'll just reach out to us. Father, I thank you for the Youth Alliance in Christ, the YAC Network, and what it provides. We only want to do two things, Lord. Point students to Christ and serve pastors. In your name we pray. Amen. So if you're watching the video, in closing, I want to just say this. You can go to the YAC Network community Facebook page. We're going to be working on that a lot this week, helping step it up, but we're getting new people all the time. If you have a question, a prayer request, anything I can do to serve you, it's easy to reach out to me at lee@leemcbride.com. I love you guys. God bless you. Have a great day.
If you believe it, if you receive it, if you can feel it, somebody testify. If you believe it.